Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that was weak. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's much better. We gather together in the name of the Lord, and this is the Lord's day to celebrate. It is the day to rejoice and be glad in this day that God has given to us. Pastor Greg Cheslow, welcome you to, Pastor Greg, I am, welcomes you to the United Methodist Church, 4th Avenue. We're so glad that you're with us this morning. A lot of empty spaces here. It's a holiday, I know. A lot of empty spaces, but it's good that you're here. I want to celebrate that you're here as well. Let me ask you to take a moment to look at your bulletin. I want to lift up a few things. In your bulletin, there are announcements that I want to ask you to take note of. Next Sunday, we are going to be honoring grandparents. Apparently, it's Grandparents' Day next Sunday. So come ready to celebrate with our grandparents. Invite a grandparent to share with you, or if you're our grandparent, invite your grandchildren to come and be with us next Sunday. The Connect card, let me call your attention to that for a moment, ask you to take a moment to sign your name there and any contact information that we don't have in the church office for you, and do that early now in the service, and later on in the service after the message, I'll invite you to turn to that again and help you to connect with how you're connecting with the Word of God. This card is very important to offer me a word of encouragement and a glimpse of how my ministry is impacting you. So please, I ask you to take note of that and fill that out, if for no other reason for me. Let us stand to sing our praises to God.
Joy in a song with freedom.
to join the collective march to higher ground, our eyes fixed on Jesus and our hearts longing for God's kingdom. And so at the beginning of this celebration of worship, as we approach to listen to the word of God and meet Christ at his table, we pause to place ourselves yet again in his presence, to confess our sin and seek God's mercy and his forgiveness. Let us pray. O Lord, we confess that we are sinners, that we fall short in fulfilling your plans for us. The selfishness and pride that weighs us down and separates us from you, forgive us. For the prejudices and the critical spirits and the judgments that so often surround us and pervade our thinking, forgive us. For the times, Lord, when we fail to see our lives as gifts from you, and to offer them again to you as a blessing to your heart and for the sake of the world, forgive us. Hear the good news, my brothers and sisters. God is patient and kind and merciful, and does not easily give up on us. His plans and purposes for us are firm and ever secure. And while we were yet stuck in sin, Christ died for us, and it proves God's great love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are freed and forgiven. Glory and thanks be to God. And all God's people rejoice, saying, Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the New Testament, the Revelation to John. After this, I saw a great crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and held palm branches in their hands, and they were shouting with a great roar, "Salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and from the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders of the four living beings. And they fell before the throne with their faces to the ground and worshipped God. They sang, Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength belong to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the 24 elders asked me, Who are these who are clothed in white? Where did they come from? And I said to him, Sir, you are the one who knows. Then he said to me, These are the ones who died in the great tribulation. They have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb and made them white. That is why they stand in front of God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will give them shelter. They will never again be hungry or thirsty. They will never be scorched by the heat of the sun. For the Lamb on the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of life-giving water, and God will wipe every tear from their eyes. Here ends the first lesson. A reading from the New Testament, the letter of the Apostle Paul to the Ephesians. Don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders. You were called uncircumcised heathens by the Jews, who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. In those days you were living apart from Christ. You were excluded from the citizenship among the people of Israel, and you did not know the covenant promises God had made to them. You lived in this world without God and without hope. But now you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to him through the blood of Christ. And for Christ himself has brought peace to us. He united Jews and Gentiles into one people when, in his own body on the cross, he broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. He did this by ending the system of law with its commandments and regulations. He made peace between Jews and Gentiles by creating in himself one new people from the two groups. Together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross, and our hostility towards each other was put to death. He brought this good news of peace to you Gentiles who were far away from him, and peace to the Jews who were near. Now all of us can come to the Father through the same Holy Spirit because of what Christ has done for us. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family. Together we are his house, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. And the cornerstone is Christ Jesus himself. We are carefully joined together in him, becoming a holy temple for the Lord. Through him, you Gentiles are also being made part of this dwelling, where God lives by his Spirit. Here ends the second lesson.
I'd like to invite the children to come as I share some moments with them this morning. Great to see all of you this morning. I'm going to need some help remembering some of your names. If you would help me with that, that would be very, very helpful. I hope that the day will come soon when I'll be able to call you all by name and it won't be hard for me at all. Now, what is your name?
Jake Lee.
Mm-hmm. I have a question for all of you. Does Jesus love Jake Lee? Yes, okay. And this is it surprise? Surprise, I know that. Does Jesus love surprise? All right, Williams, I know you, right? Does Jesus love Williams? And I should know this guy's name, but I don't. Victor, does Jesus love Victor? Yes, all right. And don't tell me, I should know this. Help me. Comfort. That's an easy name to remember. Does Jesus love comfort? Yes. Abigail is... No, it's Annabelle, right? Annabelle. I had an aunt named Annabelle. That's how I remember your name. Does Jesus love Annabelle? Yes. And your name is? Aubrey. Love that name. Does Jesus love Aubrey? So Jesus loves all of us. And does Jesus love everybody in this room? And does Jesus love everybody outside of this room? Okay, you've understood that really well. That's great. Jesus' love is so big that it covers every one of his children, every single one of us. Do you know the song, Jesus Loves the Little Children? Do you know that song? Let's all sing it together, shall we? Doug, can you give us a tune? Do you know the tune? You don't. Forgive me. Jesus loves the little children. Let's all sing it together. Now we'll sing now.
Jesus loves the little children.
Remember that Jesus loves you, you're precious in his sight, and he loves all the children of the world. Lord, help us to love as you love. Help us to know that we are loved so very much and held in high esteem and precious in your sight, and help us to treat every other person knowing that they too are loved supremely by you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks for sharing these moments with me this morning. Thank you. Our nation is reeling because of the events of Saturday, August 12th. That's chaos that erupted in Charlottesville, Virginia. And the church can't sit this one out. The book of Revelation in chapter 7 is a glorious vision, an extraordinary vision from God of the kingdom of heaven in all of its fullness. A great multitude from every nation, every tribe, every people, every language, standing before the very throne of God and before the Lamb. Of course, the Lamb is Jesus Christ. They were wearing white robes, declaring their victory, holding palm branches in their hands and waving them, crying out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Yet what we experienced just a few weeks ago, a couple more, that's the first vision. The second vision is this. What we saw a few weekends ago in Charlottesville was the exact brutal opposite of the glorious heavenly vision. Crowds filled with hate, bent on violence. We saw not dazzling robes of white washed in the blood of the Lamb, but rather we saw stains of red blood, human blood, spilled in demonic anger. And today, facing a resurgence of racism in our country, it's time for moral clarity. Eric Metaxas, who tweeted in response to the events of Charlottesville, said this: "Racism is the very antithesis of the love of Jesus for all." Let me say that again. Racism is the very antithesis, that is the opposite, the exact opposite of the love of Jesus for all. Let me say it in another dramatic way. Every racist philosophy, including white nationalism, neo-Nazi rhetoric, and images displayed by the so-called alt-right in Charlottesville, is rooted in the very pit of hell. There's no defending it. It's certainly not Christian. It's not even American. And it ought not even be associated with conservatism. I'm grateful for those political and religious leaders who claim the name of Jesus, who wasted no time in condemning the actions. We need in our time a clear Christian witness on this issue. My brothers and sisters, America has a race problem. It's been true ever since the beginning. Oh, and we've made incredible strides. Don't let me diminish that in any way, shape, or form. Indeed, we've made great strides. But only the biblical vision of God can ground what we talk about as universal dignity, value, and establish human rights. Only the biblical concept of the fall keeps us from finding the enemy only in someone else, as if the problem is always outside of ourselves. Alexander Solzhenitsyn was a native Russian and a Nobel Prize winner in literature. He wrote of this: "The line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being." Say that with me. The line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. The problem is me. The problem is you. And only the restoration that Christ brings offers any way forward past the hurt, the hate, and the history that plagues us. Only the church has that message to proclaim and put it on full display in the midst of all of the brokenness and all of the darkness that is all around us. In the midst of events such as this that tear and separate us and break the very fabric of our American family, the church's proclamation is Christ, Christ's love for all, and the door of his saving help open to all who dare to believe him. And so we must pray We must pray fervently for our country and join with God in the work of Christ, recognizing that it is only by Jesus' love that heals hurts, restores relationships, and brings unity to people who otherwise were once divided. Our baptismal vows ask us in the liturgy of baptism, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? That's very radical, dramatic language. Because living as a baptized child of God is a radical thing to do. Because God, through the baptized, is turning the world, which is upside down, right side up. And it takes a really strong, radical movement away from the way that we would normally go apart from God. Let me read the question again. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness? Reject the evil powers of this world and repent of your sin? If so, respond with me. I do. And secondly, do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If this is your case, say with me, I do. Despite the tremendous strides we've made in this country in pursuing racial reconciliation and equality in recent decades, this moment of overt racism has reeled its ugly head. It's a stain on our national character, and it's obscenity in God's great world. And so you and I have to redouble our efforts to work for justice and peace. The scriptures are clear. When you get right down to it, there is only one race, the human race. In that sense, we are all brothers and sisters made in God's image, equal in dignity and intrinsic value before Him. From God's plan of redemption, we learn that we see that all human beings created in His image, but also all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We miss the mark. We fall short. There's a disease in our souls that must be healed. The good news is that God so loved the world that He gave His only Son that whoever believes in Him may not perish, but have eternal life. And just as all of us are equally shattered vessels, we are equally candidates for God's mercy and grace. Indeed, despite our outward differences, the church is to be a spiritual and visible display of our essential unity as brothers and sisters in one family. The church from nearly the beginning was a multi-ethnic, Jews and Gentiles living side by side. Remember how Jesus reached out to the outcasts, the Samaritan woman at the well. He commended the example of the Good Samaritan for all of us to amplify. He rewarded the faith of a Canaanite woman, healing her daughter. He rewarded the faith of a Roman centurion, healing his servant. And He said, "And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to Myself." And at the very cross of Jesus, a Roman guard speaks, "Truly, this man was God's Son." In Acts chapter 2, the beginning of the church, the Pentecost, all of those people from every land, imaginable land, were gathered together in one place to hear the good news and respond. And Galatians 3:28 says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Jesus Christ." And then the vision of God's people from every tribe, nation, throne, gathered before His throne. None of this divine revelation in the scriptures is by accident. God's unshakable and irresistible goal is for people of every tongue, tribe, nation to worship His Son, Jesus Christ, to know His saving mercy and His incredible healing touch. God is glorified when people of all races gather together to worship his Son. It provides for us a picture of the coming kingdom that we can glimpse right now. In spite of all that we've accomplished together in this world and in this nation in particular, the task is not over, especially for the church. We have work to do. We have the opportunity and responsibility in this cultural moment to engage in reconciliation all the more. The first step for all of us is to invite God to shine the ray of his love into our hearts and lives. Why is it that when I drive downtown on Central Avenue and I see people of color, that fear grips my heart? Why is that? People who normally in other circumstances I would immediately reach out to, I feel distance. I feel anxious. I don't know what to do. We can pray. We can pray that God will heal the divisions that plague our American society. We must pray. And pray that God would help us to overcome the resistance that is within us so that that distance can be closed and those who are estranged can be made friends. One of the most inspiring things that I heard when I first came to Faribault, I missed it by a couple of weeks, that the Islamic Center here in Faribault had invited people in the community to come into their place for a meal and to talk about one of their sacred holidays. I thought to myself, what a perfect opportunity for the Christian community. Why not this March or April, why don't we gather our Islamic friends in one of our churches and tell them about Easter? Can we be the first ones to offer a hand of reconciliation and friendship across a great distance? Pray, brothers and sisters, for an opportunity for you. An opportunity for you to develop a relationship with a person who's different from you, from a different religious background, from a different color, from a different language. The bonds of friendship will let many, many estrangements go. In conclusion, this is a moment for us, people of God, to be bold in our witness against racism in any form, against white supremacy, and offer to the world a vision of a beloved community where all belong. Let us pray for the Holy Spirit to break through us, each one of us, break and work through us, that this world that God loves would be healed, and that the visible kingdom of God would be made manifest and seen by this world. In closing, let me suggest, let it begin with me, with you, with us. Let us pray. Lord, work through us, your beloved children, who name the name of Christ, and grant us a breakthrough within ourselves and through us. Through us, through each one of us, through us collectively, may the wall of hostility be clearly broken down. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Let us stand to sing.
We shall overcome.
me ask you to take out that Connect card again and consider the next steps that you might consider doing to take the Word of God and put it into practice in your life. I'll pray for the opportunity to develop a relationship with someone from a different race, ethnic background, economic or religious background. Or perhaps you can say, I'll take the first prayerful steps to reconcile with someone who has become distant or estranged. I'll pray that God will heal the divisions that plague American society. I'll invite God to examine my heart and shine a light on the prejudices that I hold. And to the right, if there's a sermon topic you'd like for me to address, I invite you to put that information there. Let us pray. We pray for your church, O God, for your beloved children everywhere. Where there is division, discord, and dissension, may we be peacemakers. Move human hearts by the power of your Spirit, that enemies may speak to each other again, that adversaries would join hands, and people would begin to seek to meet together. We pray that hatred would be overcome by love, and revenge give way to forgiveness, and discord be changed to mutual respect. Oh God, you know our hearts break for our brothers and sisters in Texas and Louisiana, victims of flood. Protect all who are in danger. Direct rescue efforts by first responders and emergency personnel. Give them strength and stamina. Provide water and food, shelter and equipment to meet the needs of the displaced. And blanket them all with your reassuring love. We lift up today all who labor and work. We pray for migrant workers and factory hands and farmers who labor to feed and clothe us. For parents who labor to provide for their families and care for their children. For all who seek the dignity of work and meaningful employment. We pray that workplaces everywhere would treat their workers justly, with dignity and respect. Pray for students as they begin a new school year, that the Spirit of God would grant them gifts of wisdom and understanding. We pray for teachers, for parents, for children, for administrators, all school workers. May these places be places of great learning and safe places for your children. Hear us, O Lord, as we ask that you would touch with your healing grace those who are ill in mind and body and spirit, especially Herbert and Pat and Marge and Carol and Joyce and Diane and all the others that we lift up before you in silence. Comfort those who grieve, O Lord, and send your peace to those who walk through the valley of the shadow of death. O God, you are our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Listen to the prayers of your faithful people, gathered again to celebrate your feast of victory. Lift our eyes and our hearts to the fulfillment of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen. And now let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
I'm satisfied just to catch. A little silver.
remain standing for the Great Thanksgiving. The some responses, if you desire to turn to them, they're in the faith we sing 2257. The words will be on the screen, and those of us who know it will be singing it with gusto to help. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift
up. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks
and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. From one man, Adam, you made every nation of humanity to live on the face of the earth. You made us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. So with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, singing. We offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim in song the mystery of faith. Saving banquet, endow us with the same spirit another, we pray the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing our closing hymn. Until that great and glorious day, keep on stretching yourself.